Everyone in our world treasures him because he refuses to make a fuss. He disdains fanfare and flattery. There's an intense calm at the center of his being, a sense of self-truth. He is a man neither in need or in awe of fame. And so in some ways, this evening must be hard for him. But no one ever deserved it more. Nathan, your career is an honor to music. Thank you.
And so it happened, in the 73rd year of his career, that Natan Mironovich Milstein, who has so studiously avoided fanfare and publicity all his life long, found himself in the brightest of limelights.
I never have publicity for the sake of, never. I didn't know what it means. I wouldn't know how to do it. I have enough brain to do it. But something stopped me because my mother said that. It's very difficult.
How do you remember your mother?
Lovingly. I loved my mother. I loved the way she looked, the way she talked. She was very beautiful. And
how did she look?
I can't describe that. She had something, sometimes that type that I said, now I remember I was in Lucerne and I went to eat something not far away from the place that the concert took place, concert house, and there was a lady, and she looked almost like my mother. But I didn't want to go away, but I did go away.
What did you learn from her?
What she taught me, she said, be always yourself. Don't compromise, especially in music. I try to do, that's all.
His unwillingness to compromise and his determination to find his own way of doing things have created some interesting situations with conductors. that most natural of tension points in a soloist's life. Beginning at the age of 11, in 1914, with Alexander Glazunov conducting his own concerto.
And I came on the rehearsal, and I played. And there was a moment that I did something different than what, from what is written. And then he had such moon glasses, you know, and he looked at it like that. Don't you like what I did? I said, no, no, I can. And then at the end, after the rehearsal, he said, play the way you played before.
Not all of his encounters with conductors have been quite so encouraging. But some of them have at least been entertaining.
You know that Klemperer was a very good friend of mine. And he was one, I consider him one of the greatest conductors ever lived. Not I, many people. And once I played in Montreux, and he conducted. I don't remember what, probably Mendelssohn concerto. And the manager, the organized festival in Montreux, asked me to play an encore. And I went to play. And then Klemperer came and said, Milstein, that, he said in Germany, this is not a solo recital, this is a symphony concert. I said, look, I didn't know, the manager asked me to play, I played. And then a couple of months ago, I played in Zurich, Beethoven concerto with him. And well, after the first movement of the Beethoven, before the Larghetto starts, he looks at me. I'm quite comfortable there. He approached me and said, Milstein, aber heute keine Zugabe. That means today, no encores, huh? Very convincing.
Who was the best conductor you ever played with?
Furtwängler.
Furtwängler. What did you play?
Dvořák.
Dvořák. Now you cried in Dvořák, no? Slow movement?
No.
A little bit.
Nimnoska. I think Czechs cry.
Ah.
Czechs cry because they feel that music, Czech, they escape.
I don't mean cry. I mean a little stoch in the stomach when
you
play.
Yeah, but it's very difficult to understand, but I'm not that type.
Yes, you are the type.
Are you telling me what I am now?
Why shouldn't I? You won't tell
You're
me,
adorable.
So I'm telling you.
No, really.
Nathan, you have a little stock when you play sometimes this music, no?
No.
When dee-da-da, dee-da-da. No, nothing? Just fiddle?
But I like slow movement. After the variations of Beethoven, this touches me, this I could cry. I don't cry with tears, but I have a feeling for that. When I played in Vienna, my manager was a young manager, not much experience. And it was also very early, 1930, I didn't have much experience. And my manager organized a recital, and I had good success with the recital, to such extent that the review in the press was glorious. And then he has decided to make a second recital. It was sold out. Then he wanted to make three concertos with some good conductor. It was difficult. That nobody plays rarely three concertos, Beethoven, Brahms, and Tchaikovsky. And he wanted a conductor. At that time, Franz Schalk was a wonderful conductor, and very sharp wit. And he said, I play only with Huberman. And then eventually he found out that I was good and the review was wonderful, and he accepted. Then comes rehearsal. I was so frightened. Because I knew how witty is, sharp he is. He might have said something wrong. And I played the introduction. And after I started the cascade, after the first team comes back, he does like that. And I thought, that's end, that's no more. And he says, I hate something nice to say, but it was beautiful. Ich hasse was Nettes zu sagen. Can you imagine such a friend? He said, I don't like to say nice things. Then encouraged me. I played well, very well then after that. Because even you're young, you can just be the, you can get, it's also say courage, courage, but if you get slap on the face, it's very bad.
True to his convictions, as always, he has done a great deal to encourage others, particularly young performers, often remaining in the role of friend and mentor long after their professional careers have been established.
Why are you so wrong? Paganini didn't play so fast. Good.
He is here working with Yuri Nagai, who's been coming to him for guidance for more than 10 years.
Completely well because you were so rushing, excited. Control. Don't rush.
I think his mind, it's every second he's new. He's thinking how to go up every second. I don't think he's thinking how to go up, but he's always thinking how to make better. I think he has done it every second forever his life, perhaps. I think that's very interesting. That's a very special thing, I think. I think many people in every field who does very good, they would, when they do something very good, they would think, oh, I did very well, and they would be satisfied. But I think in his case, every second he's thinking better, always better, better, better. He never think, oh, I'm so far away. He never looked like that. So it's, in his music also, every second he's new. Every time I play, he tells me a new fingering. It's too much confusing, maybe, but when fingering is new, piece become new also. So you start with new mentality. It's of course much difficult to just play same things 100 times. He even when he play 100 times same piece, he play different piece because different fingering, different moment. Every moment he's new. You know that I learned a lot. For me. Each year, last 10 years, towards the end, he's, for me, even better and better and better. That is also amazing. I met him after he's perhaps 72 or something. But to me, he was better and better and better. Of course, I don't know him before. I cannot say anything. But yeah, he was never got old. He was always like, you are born now. You are interested.
Don't make accents wrong. Da, da, da. Na, da, 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 da. Why so scherzando always? Peter. Bum. younger people now play faster. I must say, when I was young, I played very fast also, to such an extent that when I went to Professor Auer in Odessa, my teacher Stolarski brought me to his hotel, and I played. He said, play Bach, and I played presto of Bach. Presto of Bach doesn't mean that you have to run away, but I did run away, being young. And Auer tried to make rhythm so that I will not disappear suddenly. But now there are more young people playing. That's why the more young people play fast.
When did you start to slow down?
Why don't you ask me when did I start to grow up?
Yes, when did you start to grow up?
I don't know. If you have a gift of growing up, because people don't grow up. It's a gift also. You have to grow up to be a mensch. Some people don't. I did.
You also say in the book that when you get older, it's not enough to practice the technique. You need to make other changes to your interpretations. You have to think differently.
How
about
to do it? You have to be able to invent ways of doing better. Not only practice. Obviously, you have to practice. But to invent things, how to do better.
His ability to invent new ways of doing things has won him a reputation among musicians for being particularly gifted with bowings and fingerings, often making the most surprising changes at the most unexpected moments.
Do you sometimes change the fingering even on the day of a concert?
During the concert. Very often musicians in the orchestra, they play the first stand. You rehearse. The first time we rehearse, I play, let's say, first few minutes, one fingering. And then a half an hour, the same spot. They couldn't believe it. But I was very easy. For me, it was very easy. That's not quality. It's nothing to do with artistic quality. It's a comfortable.
You didn't play original boy.
No, no. Because I feel it. You are what in my opinion, tiro hero. When you do tiro pum pum, then you know what I mean?
Yeah. But I thought you played original boy.
I don't know original. Every boy in this look, who made the original boy?
Ferdinand?
No, David.
David, you're right. But Mendelssohn did too. Mendelssohn knew a lot about boys.
Not as much as I do.
You did very good boys for that.
Ah, that's a different story. Now, this is. I see that.
I think it's the ear. Sure.
Pum, 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 pum. No, that's just too sweet. Sorry. Because
I'm Zuckerman, what can I do?
Bravo. He probably always says that.
Because I like to play with the fourth finger.
It doesn't matter.
I like
but
that sound. Da, da.
I agree with you, it's a good sound. But that serves the. Wrong.
Yeah, but open string I don't like.
But you'd make modest.
Yes,
piano.
I changed my mind a few years ago. Mm-hmm.
Okay. Where are your fingerings? Do you have them in a part?
I never have a fingerings because I change all the time.
Sure.
But that's a lovely violin. It looks so good.
Very good. Yeah.
Enjoy that.
Well, I have a very long stretch this way.
The Paganini also.
Yeah. This also I have a very long stretch. So I don't do 2-4. I do 3-4 all the time.
Ah.
So I'm lucky.
Very lucky. Paganini was luckier.
Yes, he was.
Therese Milstein, when did you first meet Natan Mironovich?
When I first saw him or met him. Because at the age of 13, my parents took me to a concert in Bucharest. That's when I heard him the first time. And my heart went like this. It was just the age when you start looking at me. Then I met him in Paris. Actually, I was sitting in a box with his former wife. I went to school in Paris, and the people who represented him, Theo Izai, were friends of the agent in Bucharest, who my parents knew very well. And I was allowed to be taken out of the school, pensionnat, for afternoon concerts. So I was in the box of Theo Izai, where his first wife was there. She was dressed up beautifully and a former model. And I was in my school uniform, that's number two. Number three, we met again in London at the party after his concerts. We were both married, so that was that. Number four, we went to New York. I divorced, he divorced, and I went backstage, and we discovered that we are both alone. So he started calling me up and taking me to concerts. The opera, and 2 years later, we fell in love. And then we married in 1945. With Natan, we are married now 45 years. I never had a dull moment. Even now, you know, I don't know what he'll do an hour later because he changes his mind.
What did you like about him when you first met him?
Many things. First of all, his looks. He was very good looking. He was slim. He had gypsy eyes, which appealed to me. His great talent, of course. Each time he played, I was shaken. And also his honesty deep down. He never said a lie in his life. He doesn't know what it is. He never gossiped. If you tell him gossip, 5 minutes later, it's gone, you know. So I had great respect, and that's important.
What does he do now? That since he hurt his hand, what does he occupy himself
with? He makes arrangements for violin, from orchestra pieces, from piano pieces, and that keeps him busy all day because he's so passionate about it.
His transcriptions developed from his passion for the violin and his exceptional mastery of the instrument. But they began with a concert in New York and a set of variations on themes by Paganini, which have become known as Natan Milstein's Paganiniana.
I made variations on Paganini, and I was, for many, many decades, trying to make it. But I didn't have courage, I was very busy playing myself. But once in the recital in New York, I need a piece of 10 minutes. And I gave the program. I said, look, that will be Paganini variations, my one. And up to the day before the concert, I was trying to do. This is the main theme.
In Denka.
Then variations. But I use the material from many caprices of Paganini, the concerto, campanella. But I made a little bit, I added variations. And then some variations I emphasized more than Paganini did. Very good, Rachmaninoff loved that. I like myself, like I scratch that violin at that moment. Now I don't scratch anymore because I can't play. I hurt my hand.
He can no longer play the violin, but inventive as always, he's now making piano parts for Paganini caprices.
What's the piece, Nathan?
What?
What is the piece?
That's Paganini Caprice. I make a piano part, it's very good. Looks wonderful. Because you see, when you only piano, violin, some harmonies get lost. Because, yeah, Parisian. Voice is very good.
When did you start transcribing?
1932.
Why? How?
Because there were always many things in my mind about pieces that didn't give the maximum effect of the subject, of the music. And then I used to make, I made some arrangements, like for instance, Mephisto Waltz. This I made already lately. Because already, but the idea of doing it came to me when I heard my sister play the Mephisto Waltz. True that she didn't play very well. But even later, Mr. Horowitz played quite well. But that was noisy. That was not, Mephisto doesn't scream. He's conniving in a corner with him. For me, it was violin better devilish than piano. The pianist sits so comfortably on a chair, but the violin is sent up, and you can make all kinds of gestures. But if you do all the piano gestures, you miss the music. Anyway, I did it, and it felt very good. And some of my colleagues played that. No, but the thing is, that's very important. First, you should be convinced that the music that you want to describe at the violin will be better than at the piano. My Mephisto was just not better. It's better only in the idea. Mephisto, it's good on the piano, but that's not Mephisto. But on the violin, it's more effective because it's more tricky. Piano is always percussive. Here you can do ponticello and spiccato and everything. And that's very good. And many good pianists, Barenboim and Serkin, they loved it. And who am I to contradict? But then I made, at the same time, Liszt also.
Natan Mironovich Milstein was born on the last day of 1903 in Odessa, a very musical town on the Black Sea, which has produced an extraordinary number of talented sons and daughters.
In our town, it was very musical. We had Philharmonic Orchestra, Symphonic Orchestra, and then Opera Orchestra. Everything was good, because the Odessa people were very smart, musically. The conservatory, wonderful, teachers, wonderful. And obviously that result is that people attracted talent, and they, talent produced quality.
Do you remember the first concert you went to?
That I went to? No, the first concert I went with, my mother took me to Heifetz. I start my book like that. But
how was it?
I didn't know anything. I was very young. I was not yet seven. I always say 7 o'clock. No, it was in, Heifetz came to play with the orchestra.
And it was not only Heifetz. Before the age of 11, in Odessa, he had also heard Jan Kubelik, Bronislav Huberman, and Eugenie Zay, all of them legendary violinists in their own time.
Zay was very famous already, and our pupils at the conservatory were very anxious to go in, and you couldn't get a ticket. Even if you could get, we didn't have money. What happens that we divided our group in two. One group will make noise while the other group will go in, so that police is diverted a little bit. And that was very successful. And I told Isaiah in June 1926, he couldn't stop laughing. That's the whole story how we came here.
Was it in June 1926 that you went to study with him? What happened? How did you, write to him?
No, I didn't write. I simply went there. And I didn't have anything special. I arrived there. You lived in Brussels. You know, Zoet. You know Zoet? Near Ostende. And I rang at the bell, and the lady came. She says, "What do you want?" I said, "I would like to play for Lemaître." And Lemaître was asleep after lunch. He was always bathing. And I said, she says, "He will not listen to you because he's too tired after lunch." And I obviously was upset. I showed that upset. I probably talked too loud. And he came out absolutely naked. He says, "What is the wrong? What's trouble?" I said, she says, "The little boy wants to play for you." And he said, why do you want him not to play?" She says, "If he doesn't play well, we send him home. He plays well, tell me." And when he told me, "What do you want to play?" I said, "Paganini." He said, "Which one you will play?" I say, "Maître, what caprice you want me to play?" It sounded a little bit impertinent, but I did play all the caprices. Even now, I could play half of them. That's how I played, and he was very glad. He said, "Why don't you come tonight to play chamber music? The Queen will play second violin, and you play viola, and I play the first violin." Catastrophe, because he was drinking vino rosso, and she couldn't play violin, and the cellist was very bad. Everything was catastrophe. But at so certain time, it was not very good, and we stopped. He said to the Queen, "Ma petite, my little one," he says, "wait a moment." For me, it was strange. I wouldn't say that to Queen, "my little one." But he was very, very popular in, at that time generally. He gave me a big viola to play. I couldn't even stretch a hand, because he used to play viola also, but he was a big fellow, but hands very big.
How long did you study with him?
3 days. No, 3 weeks. I didn't study with him. He didn't tell me anything.
But did you enjoy it?
Yeah. I enjoyed his personality, not so much in music. You know, as I said before, tune the violin with temperament. That's why his violin never was tuned. beautiful. But he was very extraordinary man. In Russia, in Odessa, after the concert, he came out. He was a great police with the fur. Took the watch, he says. You have to go home, sleep. I believe he went to the nightclub because somebody saw you in that nightclub.
And so, Izai left a lasting impression on his young audience. And Odessa's musical son remembered the famous visitor for his personality, his temperament, and for his playing of Sarasate's Introduction and Tarantella.
I love that piece. This is a showing off masterpiece of Sarasate, because he did for himself. Really lovely.
Thank you. In 1925, after several successful tours of the Soviet Union, two children of the revolution, Vladimir Horowitz and Natan Milstein, were sent abroad for purposes of artistic refinement and cultural propaganda.
Assistant of Trotsky was Uborevich, the Russian general, and he said, why don't you go to outside of Russia? For for finishing your studies and some showing that Soviet is not only materialistic.
Not long afterwards, they found themselves in a box at a concert of Fritz Kreisler's in Paris, and the experience was to have lasting effect.
There was a concert, Kreisler in Grand Opera, Paris, and he played three concertos. And with Horowitz, we sat in a box. And well, we were so fascinated, hypnotized, that after he finished everything, after the applause, we sat like that. And there was an old man, usher, and he says, gentlemen, you know, the concert is over. And we couldn't do anything. We were so impressed.
In your book, you imply that the impression that concert made on you was one of the reasons for deciding to remain in the West.
No, I decided to be in West because after Rakovsky, Soviet ambassador, told us, don't go yet, you didn't play enough for the capitalist. Came another ambassador, Soviet, who used to take people from the street and send them to Russia. It was a Stalin regime. And we decided not to go. Chrysler, maybe indirectly, Chrysler influenced also.
And so the children of the Soviet Revolution remained in the West, lighting fires of enthusiasm wherever they went. And as they grew up, they lost their youthful title. And with Grigor Piatigorsky, acquired the new affectionate label of the Three Musketeers.
Piatigorsky was like Niagara Falls, like Natan describes Horowitz, the play, but Piatigorsky as a human being was like that. The first time I met him, he took me like that and squeezed me out. And so much love and so much tenderness, so much wit. He was unique, really, in a way. And being so tall and so strong, it was impressive. But what was the touching moment is when Natan gave master classes in Zurich. Towards the end, Piatigorsky had lung cancer. He smoked a lot all day long. And he knew that he doesn't have much to live. So Natan said, look, my friend Piatigorsky, he's not well, but maybe he will come. They called Piatigorsky in California. I said, I'll come, but not for master classes, only to see Natanchik, because I know I'm very sick. So he arrived, and he gave a few master classes, but not many. But then he used to sit at the back to listen to Natan's master class. And one day, he says, Natanchik, let's pay for the students Rosemary, a song, you know, that they played when they were very young. He got up, he went there, he took a cello from the student, and he started to play. Oh, Rosemary. And that was a moment I can't forget. I was in tears, knowing that he's going to die soon. He returned to California. 2 weeks later, he was dead. And I still have a letter from Jacqueline, his wife. He married one of the Rothschild. And she says Piatigorsky had only one friend that he really loved, and it was Natanchik. I kept it. And that's a moment I always remember.
And so the first of the Three Musketeers, who so lit up the musical world in the 1920s, fell silent. Grigor Piatigorsky died in Los Angeles in 1976, at the age of 73. Natan Milstein and Vladimir Horowitz lost a lifelong friend, and the world lost one of the most glorious cello talents of the 20th century. 13 years later, Vladimir Horowitz died in New York at the age of 85. And in 1987, when he was 83 and still playing as the grandest of grandmasters, Natan Milstein's performing career suddenly ended because of an accident to his left hand. But after a career that rose and continued to rise steadily for 73 years, he remains as close to music as his circumstances will allow. He continues to listen with passion, to encourage and guide young players, and he continues to work at his miraculous transcriptions for the instrument which he loves so dearly.
If I don't like a piece, I don't transcribe. But if I like a piece, and I think it can be better than the violin, I transcribe it. And most of the time, when I think like that, it's successful.
How did you come to transcribe the piece from Tchaikovsky's Mazeppa?
Oh, because Mr. Horowitz gave me Tchaikovsky's opera manuscript. And there I saw that Mazeppa had a daughter. And she was in love with one of his officers. And that's during the war, many, many centuries ago. She came to visit the headquarters and asked him, the father, about her boyfriend. And he said, unfortunately, the boy was killed in the battle. And very upset, obviously, shattered. She came through the forest home, and in the forest there were hundreds of soldiers crying and moaning. And she somehow blindly approached one that she thought that it's her boyfriend. And she starts, then she thinks, this is, she says, "Spi, mladenic." I will try to translate from Russian. "Spi, mladenic, moj prekrasny." Sleep, my baby, my child, glorious, beautiful. Bayushki, bayu. It's very spooky when the flute does it, you know.
Thank you.
Tell me, Natan Mironovich, do you think about death?
Death? I rarely, but when you are old already, you're forced to think a little bit. It doesn't attract me. But I can't help it. That's the end anyway. It's like a rent. You rent your life. And then the time comes that you have to give up your apartment. You know what I mean? It's not so forever. But I don't regret the past. I never regret because it was very lovely for me. And then after, I was occupied with something that was so dear to me. Now, music. I was young, but music, middle-aged music, and old-age music.
Good life?
I think so. I can't be sure. But I think it's good. But if you love music, it's already something good. If you love music, you're more completed without it.
Natan Mironovich.
Thank you.
Spasibo bolshoye.
Пожалуйста. Take off that machinery.